Your story, you know, my understanding is you lost both your legs at 17. You're now helping others that have gone through similar things and helping them in their future. Could you just share a little bit about maybe what happened and really how it's shaped what you're doing today?
Yeah, sure. As a young man, I was passionate about mountain climbing. And when I was 17, I was in a mountain climbing accident and suffered frostbite. And my medical team gave up the fight to save my biological limbs, and they were amputated just below the knee. So today, I use very high-tech powered prostheses to stand, walk, and run. So from that experience, I really realized how limited the current prosthetic technology was, and I really dedicated my life as a young man to really advance the field and enable extraordinary technology that will allow people to do what they want again, to move again.
Well, and if I'm
have the bodies that they seek.
Right, and my understanding, you've been at the MIT Media Lab for I think 21 years. You have a Doctor of Philosophy from Harvard. What has changed when it comes to prosthetics since you joined the lab?
Yeah, good question. When I was first fitted with prostheses when I was 17, the prostheses were made of wood and foam and metal. They didn't have any computational intelligence, no sensories, information, no actuation. And I said to myself at the time, really, this is it? This is what society can provide? Today, there exist computer-controlled prostheses that adapt and are even connected to the human nervous system that can convey human agency and ownership and really restore physicality for humans.
So if that's what exists today, then what's coming in the next 10, 20 years? What are you working on?
Yeah, we are laser focused on integrating human biology with mechatronics. Our key goal is to connect the human brain to a built construct like an exoskeleton or a prosthesis. Our mission is to restore physicality. In the case of when a person loses a limb, or in a case where a person suffers a stroke and has paralysis, or has muscular weakness or joint damage, we can build these bionic systems to restore movement.
I am curious too, and you know, we've been doing these segments for a while, and often we do any kind of medical segment, we do think about the differences between men and women. And I'm curious how, what you've come across when it's, you know, developing technologies or outcomes or prosthetics for men versus women. Are there differences?
Yeah, absolutely. In the case of limb amputation, amputations caused by traumatic injury are predominantly performed on men. It's about, in the US, it's about 70% men and 30% women. Hmm. So because of that male dominance, the prosthetic technology seems to be developed through the lens of needs that men face and not women. So there's a tremendous need to develop truly personalized prosthetic limbs that reflect the needs of the individual and don't have that male bias. And that's a key area of research here at MIT.
Is that male bias because of war and military or no?
I mean, it's typical for traumatic injury that there be a male dominance. I won't make a joke there, but whether it be spinal cord injury due to car crashes or amputation, there's typically more men than women. So the prosthetic industry needs to not only reflect the needs of men, but also obviously of women.
I have to say,
and that's a tremendous focus for our research.
No, I've got four brothers, two sisters, and my brother's man, risk takers, and there were more accidents and runs to the emergency room.
And broken, I didn't want to say that.
And broken limbs and things, unfortunately. So yeah, we definitely saw that.
100%.
So Hugh, I'm wondering about at what point, look, and it's a question that we have when it comes to any innovation, but we know that the work is always ongoing and the work will always continue. But what is the ultimate outcome? And when do you think we're going to be able to get there? You said the goal is to have this type of medical device be completely controlled by the human and as close to somebody's limb as actually possible. Can you give us a timeline when you will say we have achieved this?
Yeah, again, broadly, we're rebuilding limbs after amputation. We're also augmenting limbs that are fully flesh and bones. For in the case of a woman suffering a stroke, for example, we want to restore the functionality of her leg, as an example. Or a person with that suffers osteoarthritis, we want to allow them to move again without pain. What's the broad goalpost? What's the broad goal? That, you know, that people don't experience unwanted limitation, unwanted disability. Imagine a world where when you lose a limb or you have a spinal cord injury or suffered a stroke or have joint disease, that you can move again. You can move without pain. You can dance again if you'd like. That's the world that we seek.
One thing I want to ask you, and certainly in terms of, I think about diabetes and how much that impacts our population, and that can lead to certainly difficulties or amputations, certainly with
sure.
feet, toes, all that stuff that certainly impacts your mobility. GLP-1 drugs, is that something you think about and how that might impact some of what you are doing in that regard?
I mean, any strategy that, you know, in time mitigates the probability of an amputation being required from a severe diabetic state is, of course, fantastic. In many developed nations of the world, the cases of diabetes are increasing precipitously, and some of the cases are so severe that amputation results and prostheses are required. So yeah, we can approach the problem in two ways. A, preventing a severe state of diabetes. And in cases when there is an amputation that occurs, developing extraordinary bionics that enables a person to restore their movement capacity, their cardiovascular capacity, and maintain a high level of health.